Hi, I'm Nick Adman.
And I'm Kyle Marsh.
And we're program managers in the Microsoft Identity Customer Experience Organization. And in this video, we'll give an overview of what the Microsoft Identity Platform is and what it offers for developers. So I'll set us up with a bit of context. You may have heard about the idea of a digital transformation. The idea here is that productivity in commerce is increasingly happening through interconnected apps and services that we access through an increasing number of personal devices. For developers, this means that we want the apps that we write today to be able to connect all sorts of people and things together to allow productive collaboration. But the question becomes, how do we do this in a way that keeps users and data secure? A solution to this is to use identity as the control plane. The Microsoft Identity Platform can handle the process of authenticating and authorizing users of your applications. This means that the platform will do the heavy lifting for you of signing in users and getting them access to protected resources. And we take advantage of the interconnectedness to increase security and provide useful contextual data. All right, so with that context, Kyle will do a demo of what the authentication experience looks like and what the corresponding code looks like. Then we'll highlight some of the key features that we offer for developers.
Thanks, Nick. What we have here is a single-page JavaScript application. I'm going to go ahead and sign in. Now, I want you to see that the first time I authenticate into this application, what actually happened is single sign-on occurred. The application authenticated the user by calling Microsoft Identity, but because the user is already authenticated onto this device, we didn't have to prompt the user for his username and password or credentials again. We can simply sign in the user silently, so single sign-on. This is important for a couple of reasons. Obviously, it's a lot more convenient for users not to have to repeatedly type in their credentials, but it's actually a security feature that they don't. We want to see users authenticate to systems rarely, maybe once per device. That way, when they do get prompted for their credentials, it gives them some pause instead of just blindly typing them in, because what we found is the more users don't think about anything when they type in those credentials, the more vulnerable they become to things like phishing attacks. So I've got my application authenticated with Microsoft Identity. Therefore, I can do things like call Microsoft Graph to see these identity APIs give me things like the user's full profile information, or I can use Microsoft Graph to do things like integrate directly into Office 365 Mail. So by using the Microsoft authentication system, I get access to all of these great functionalities within the Microsoft Graph as well. Now, if I signed in the this actually look at where you can see an actual authentication take place. For that, we're going to switch over to an in-private browser so it doesn't pick up the fact that I've authenticated on this device already. So let's click our sign-in button again. This time, of course, we will get prompted. I'll go ahead and pick my identity. And now, notice that this user is actually configured for passwordless authentication. So I'm not going to be prompted for a username and password. Instead, I'm getting prompted to match the number displayed with the one from my phone. I'm going to get prompted for an additional factor with my Touch ID here. And now I've fully authenticated to this application using passwordless authentication. This is something we want to see a lot of enterprises move to because, again, it's very convenient, but also it's a lot more secure because we are not just using a shared secret, which is a password, but rather true cryptography to really make sure that this authentication process is done in the most secure possible way. And it's important that your applications move to being able to support these different ways of authentication, fully supporting single sign-on, supporting passwordless, supporting MFA, in order to move your enterprise and your users to this more secure posture, so that they can be protected, both their data and their identities. Let's look at the code behind the making our application fully capable of doing single sign-on, passwordless authentication. The same JavaScript web application could also, for example, support MFA, multi-factor authentication. So there's a few APIs you need to use. We're going to use our MSOL library, the Microsoft Authentication Library, for JavaScript. Where we've taken all of the complexity of working at the protocol level and instead made it into a very straightforward API for that you can use. So here, for example, I'm going to use my MSOL library and call my login API. By calling that login API here in my JavaScript app, that supports all of the various ways that a user could authenticate, passwordless, MFA, username and password, etc. And all I have to do in my application is simply ask to sign in the user. The next thing that we're going to use MSOL for is we're going to use MSOL in order to get access tokens so that the we can call Microsoft Graph and get that, say, that full user profile or the user's email information so I could integrate mail directly into my application. So to do that, we're going to use a couple of APIs. So the pattern we want everyone to use using our MSOL libraries is, first off, we attempt to acquire a token silently. This means acquire the token, but do not prompt the user for anything. Simply, if the mechanism is in place, single sign-on, consent has been granted, etc., go ahead and give me the token silently. Don't interrupt the user's flow. However, if Microsoft Identity does need to talk to the user, maybe their password changed, maybe some they're in a different location, there's lots of different reasons why we might need to prompt the user contact the user again. And if that's the case, then your application falls back to acquire a token interactively, in this case with acquire token pop-up in our JavaScript library. So by learning those three APIs, login, acquire token silent, and acquire token pop-up, I provided the vast majority of capabilities I need in order to fully integrate my application with Microsoft Identity. And let's take a look at what we get from that. Well, so as Nick pointed out, Microsoft is the new control plane. One of the big, very popular features with our customers nowadays is something called conditional access. This really represents the kind of sophistication that's needed today to truly protect your users and the data that they have access to. What conditional access does is, for every single authentication, we evaluate the conditions. What device is it? Is the device managed? Is the state of the device? Where is the request coming from? What kind of data is the request going to? We evaluate all of those in conjunction with the policy set by the particular IT departments. We would prefer that we want that only if you're accessing this information, you must be on my network. Or perhaps if you do this operation, we require an additional MFA prompt or something like that. In fact, we can go further. If, as we look at a lot of signals across all of the internet, when we determine that a user has a password breach, their password has been stolen, the enterprise could say, well, given that condition, the user has to reset their password now. This is all work that a developer would have to do in order to truly protect your application in today's age of very sophisticated attackers. In the case of using Microsoft Identity, it's just those three APIs I just talked about. Login, acquire token silent, acquire token interactively. The rest of this sophistication that needs to happen for real protection is handled by the platform. So what do we offer in the Microsoft Identity platform? Well, it starts with our endpoints. We have fully OpenID Connect certified endpoints, so you can access them with a number of different technology. We also, of course, support SAML and even WSFed with our endpoints as well. So fully standards compliant endpoints so that your application can easily authenticate. Next, of course, to make that process as a developer a lot easier, we do provide a family of Microsoft authentication libraries, our MSOL libraries, across a variety of different languages and technologies so that you can really use Microsoft Identity in a very easy way in your application, as we just showed in that JavaScript app. The next thing, of course, is by using our libraries and endpoints and our authorization requests, we give you access, we enable access to a wide variety of web APIs. Well, top of the list here, of course, is those Microsoft Graph APIs, but any APIs from other parts of Microsoft or even your own APIs can be fully protected with Microsoft Identity. Another new feature that we're adding at our platform level is the ability for you as a developer to have your application published as from a verified publisher. This means when a user sees that you're asking for access to data on their behalf, they'll see that you're actually coming from a publisher who has been fully verified by Microsoft to be the real publisher of that application. This can really help your uptake of your application, make it easier for your application to get adopted by enterprises and customers. Now, these components work across a set of identities. Now, to begin with, of course, the simplest one is I have an identity in, say, an Azure Active Directory. I work for a company or a school, and we have our work and school accounts. Those are companies with users with accounts in their Azure Active Directories. We also support the full extent of the Microsoft personal accounts. That's something like an Outlook.com or a Skype.com or even Xbox.com. We run all of that infrastructure as part of the Microsoft identity. And without a change to that application, I could have authenticated, for example, with a user from their Outlook account as well. And finally, we do have the ability for you to reach out or developers to reach out to their customers directly, where the customer can bring their own identity. So instead of having a Microsoft account or an Azure Active Directory account, I might allow my users to use their Facebook or Twitter or Google accounts in order to do that authentication. So our Azure AD B2C product allows you to build customer-facing solutions. And I will note, of course, that all of this build is built across a standard set of industry standards that are really widely adopted by every player in the identity business. So things like OpenID Connect, which is built on top of OAuth2, or more traditional or older standards like SAML or WSFed, and our SCIM standard, all allow you as a developer to not only build on top of our libraries, but if you find an environment where you don't have a library, you can go looking for something, for example, like a certified OpenID Connect library, and simply use that because we are fully standards compliant. Now, again, a key component of what you get by adopting the Microsoft identity is this access to web APIs in a protected manner. The Microsoft 365 platform consists of a lot of data in Microsoft Graph, which is the data that drives the productivity in the enterprise, that you can use the Microsoft Graph API to really enhance the value of your solution. Whether you're building your own experience, a web app, or a daemon app of some description, or whether you're integrating into the various Microsoft 365 endpoint experience themselves. Perhaps you've got an extension for Outlook, or you're building something on top of Microsoft Teams. All of that really starts coming together when you start calling the Microsoft Graph API. And once you've authenticated a user with a Microsoft identity, then you're able to use those Microsoft Graph APIs in your own solutions. Another key thing for developers to think about is this idea of user provisioning. How do your customers add and remove users to your application? How do they assign various roles to users in your application? So given that you're providing them a solution, how do they manage the users within that solution? Well, the easiest way is to simply have Azure Active Directory do that automatically for them directly into your application. So all I need to do, for example, is add a user to my enterprise, and it automatically becomes a user in your application. Similarly, I might add a user to a particular group. That group might be approvers of invoices for your application. And again, it all happens automatically. Now, the way that this automatic provisioning can happen is by you as a developer providing what's referred to as a SCIM endpoint. SCIM is another industry standard. It's not a Microsoft standard, but although we really like it and contribute, but it's industry-wide. So the work you do to make your application automatically provisionable for Microsoft Identity works across the identity industry. So we really encourage you to implement a SCIM endpoint in your application. Now, to take a look at the kind of our publisher verification system, what happens today when a publisher is verified is you notice you get our blue check mark, meaning that Microsoft has verified that this is the right publisher of this application. The user can drill in, for example, and get more information about the publisher. This can really help users be more accepting of your application, be more confident that you are getting the right application from the right developer. And therefore, you make your application easier to be deployed across your enterprises and customers. Even some of our partners, like Apple, have gone ahead and become verified publishers and made their applications show the verified publisher work. When I use some Apple things on things like iOS and Mac OS, I see a verified publisher option.
Okay, so to close us out, this final slide has the highlights of what we talked about today. We hope that you enjoyed the video and found it useful. And to learn more, you can go to aka.ms/developeroverview/docs.